Well, welcome to the Cinnabar. Today we're going to revisit this Winchester 1892 and 2520. We tried to test fire it in our last episode and found that the firing pin was too short, so we think we've got that problem remedied, so we'll take a few shots with it just to try it out. And then we're going to head down to the shop. We need to do a little work on this really nice early Marlin 1893 and 3855. The fellow that sent this up from Abilene, Texas, now there's a great place for lever guns, right? Says he suspects headspace problems. There's been having some misfires with it and backing out primers and whatnot. So we'll take a look at how to diagnose a headspace problem and some different ways that maybe we can correct a headspace issue. So stick around. We'll get a little shooting in with this 2520 and then we'll fix this old girl up and see if she can't shoot as well. Okay, before we head down the hill to work on that old Marlin, let's check out this Winchester 1892 and 2520. Make sure we've got it fixed up and firing now. That's the sound we were after. In this case, the firing pin that came out of it was not only 25 thousandths too short, but it was in really rough shape. It had been welded on, there was porosity in the weld, it wasn't even ground straight, so it was cheaper and easier just to replace it with a replacement mail order piece that was only $25, and it cost more to have me re-tip that one. We'll save that one and re-tip it sometime in the future. Show you how to do that with some tool steel or drill rod, make a really great firing pin that way, but it does take a little bit of time, more time than $25 would pay for. And this one, you remember, had some feeding problems. That's why it came into the shop. So we're gonna put a few in the magazine and see if we can't get them feeding properly now. It had all sorts of problems with feeding. Okay, let's put our eyeballs back on and see if we can't ring a few bells here. It's feeding great, it's shooting now. Heck, I got an empty right on my hat there. And it's ready to go back to old Frank. He's been great. He's loaned me several guns and sent me this one to get fixed up for him. I think he's going to be pretty happy to see this one firing again. Let's head down to the shop and work on that old 93 now. For those of you who follow the channel, you know that we collect and we shoot a lot of Colts and Winchesters around here. But that doesn't mean we don't have an appreciation for these Marlins. In fact, quite the opposite is true. These things are really simply built, they're rugged designed, easy to work on. They're just a fantastic old rifle. And in some ways, I think they're even superior to the Browning Design Winchester lever actions. I know I'll catch some flack from my Winchester buddies about saying that, but anyway, these are a great little gun. This is 1893, is probably the most popular of the Marlins, in the same or similar calibers to the 1894 Winchester, with the square bolt here. Well, they got redesigned with a round bolt later on, became the 336, which is extremely popular even today. This one's in real nice shape. A lot of finish left on it. The wood hasn't been all beat up. It's a very early model. This one letters, or it, the serial number makes it about an 1894 production. So Marlin didn't start making smokeless steels until 1895. So this is a black powder version of the 1893 Marlin. So that may have contributed to the suspected headspace problem that we have with this one. Because I'll bet you anything, it's been shot a whole lot with full powered 3855 smokeless loads. So with the owner suspecting headspace from those backed out primers and misfires that he's been having, first thing we need to do is check and make sure that the lever's closing all the way. Sometimes we get a bent lever and the back end of it's touching and you see a big gap up in the front end. These Marlins are pretty tough, but occasionally if somebody's had a jam or something, they really tried to crank on it, they can bend that lever. Or you can get a tang screw that's sticking out a little bit or something like that and keeping that lever from closing all the way. So we want to make sure the lever's closed all the way. And then we're going to use a no-go grade gauge and see if maybe it'll close on it. Now, if you know about go and no-go gauges, they're really used for
cutting new chambers. If we're over on the lathe cutting a new chamber, that's the minimum and maximum headspace that we can get on a new chamber. So we really kind of expect that this will close on a no-go, and it does. It closes really easily. It would be surprising for a gun this old to not close on a no-go cage. But the test, if we can get this, here we go. The test is a field gauge. Now a field gauge, the rim thickness on a 3855 is 63 thousandths. This field gauge is 70 thousandths, and that's the maximum allowable SAMI headspace. If it closes on this, then we know we've got an issue that we need to take care of. Yes, and it closes easily, okay? So we probably have an issue. We do have an issue. Now, in, you know, 3855, 3030, if you've got a little extra headspace, it's probably okay. It's not as critical as some of the more high-powered Magnum cartridges. But a field gauge only tells us that we're over the maximum. So we don't know how far over the maximum we are. Now, there's a simple trick. It's not perfect. I mean, it's not super scientific, but it involves Scotch tape. Now, Scotch tape is about 2/1000ths of an inch thick. So what I did before I started the camera up, I put enough layers of Scotch tape on here on this field gauge and then trimmed them up that wouldn't close all the way. So I ended up with 7 layers of Scotch tape on here and it doesn't quite close. Okay, we came up just shy of closing. That when I mic'd it, then we ended up actually with 15/1000ths excess headspace. We gained 1/1000th of an inch in there with our 7 layers. So that's well beyond maximum safe headspace. So we do need to fix this thing up. So we're going to get set up here and talk about how to correct headspace. And there we do have some options. In fact, there are several options to correct headspace. So we'll go through, we'll take this thing apart. You're going to see how simple it is to take a 1893 Marlin apart and decide what method we're going to use to correct this headspace issue.
Okay, so in order to take up the extra headspace, we got one of two choices. We can either move the breech face of the barrel back, or we can move the bolt face forward to take up that extra space. Now, to move that breech face of the barrel back would mean we would have to take the barrel out, cut one more thread into the barrel, cut the chamber a little bit deeper, and then reform anything on the back of the barrel. In the case of a Marlin that doesn't have a flat breech face on the barrel, it's got these extensions that are milled right on the end of the barrel here that help guide the nose of the cartridge into the bore. It's a kind of a difficult thing to do a setback on these. They have a kind of an odd square thread as well. Not a great option, especially with collectible guns, because you are going to shorten the barrel up a little bit. Not a lot, but it does shorten it a little. We're going to have to shorten the magazine tube as well to match it. So probably our best bet is to try to move the whole bolt or just the bolt face forward.
Okay, so let's take a look at how easy it is to take these Marlins apart. The first thing we're going to do, of course, is take off the buttstock. And we're just going to take this tang screw out. Always be really careful when you're taking these tang screws out. It's so easy to slip out and put a ding in the wood. Most of them, the tangs aren't exactly straight anymore, so they'll spring a little bit one way or the other. That one come out actually pretty easy, and I had it off earlier. Okay, so we've got that apart. Now we need to take out the mainspring, and we'll need a 90 degree screwdriver to do that. Okay.
So next we're going to take out the finger lever, and it's really easy on these Marlins. We'll just open up the action a little bit, take this screw out, And the lever and the bolt aren't connected. This part of the lever just rides in a notch in that bolt and brings it back and forth. So once that screw is out of there, the lever comes right out. Now we can take the lower tang out, and that's just the hammer screw here holds both the hammer and the lower tang. We've got another screw up here on the front, just a little short guy. We'll pull it out. I usually try to, if there's two screws holding something in, loosen one of them up a little bit and then go get the others. Takes a little of the bent tension or the bind off of them. So here we'll take this screw out. And the lower tang will come out with the hammer. And now we'll take the locking block out. And the bolt should come right out. Okay, so we've got it pretty much taken apart. We've got a couple of more items, the loading gate, which we really don't need to take out for our purposes. And the bolt is still in here, but the bolt is, or not the bolt, but the carrier is still in here. And that's a real easy one to take out as well. We just got this one screw. Pull that out and the carrier will come out, and there we have it. I mean, we've dismantled the inner workings of a 1893 Marlin. You know, we could take the fore end and the mag tube out, but we don't really need to. This pretty much empties it out. So let's look at what we need to do now to move this bolt face. Okay, so we've decided not to do a barrel setback. But we've always got it as an option. If we can't take up this headspace another way, we can always go back and set that barrel back. So that leaves us with our next option, and that's to move this bolt face forward. We've got a couple different ways we can do that. Now, first off, we could weld up this bolt face and then machine it back, leave it, you know, 10, 12, 15 thousandths thicker. But there's a couple problems with that. One, it's not a real clean bolt face here. You see, we've got these protrusions that are machined in that are just the exact same depth as the cartridge rim. So if we fill that up, we're going to change that depth. We're going to be really difficult to clean all that weld up in that area. Now, it's possible to do, but it's a real pain. So our other option is this locking block fits up into this groove right here to lock this bolt in place. So if we weld a little bit on the front of that, machine it back, we can move that bolt forward just a little bit. But the problem is there's very little room in here and in the slot in the receiver where this rides to do that. So we can only take up a few thousandths. And we know we need to take up more than a few thousandths to correct headspace here. Now let me show you how this all works together here. Move this receiver out of the way. Now remember, the finger lever just works in a groove and these... rather than being pinned in, and then we've got the locking block here, and as the lever rotates, moves forward, it pushes up that locking block into that groove. Okay, so now we're kind of running out of options here, but the nice thing is they're readily available through mail order, these factory-made Marlin bolts through Numerich, and they're really reasonably priced. So I ordered one of these, and one of the things I really like about it is that they actually angled this groove a little bit. So as that locking block goes up, it pushes the bolt forward just a little bit. And so that gives us a little more room to work with and a little more room for fitting. So let's give this one a try and see if we can't get it fit up and without doing a whole bunch of welding or barrel setbacks and all that kind of good stuff.
Okay, so earlier we showed you just how easy it was to take a Marlin lever action apart. Now we're going to put it back together, and it's just as easy. We're going to take the locking block,
put it back in. I did actually put the carrier in first. Going to put this hammer in back here. I guess we put it the right way. Put the lower tang in. Get these lined up. The hammer and the tang here. Put in the screw. And here we go.
We're not going to tighten it all the way before we put this front little screw in. Tighten it up. Tighten this one down. We're going to put the bolt in, the lever in, put the lever screw in. Put another tip in that works a little better. Then we're going to put in the mainspring. Remember our 90 degree screwdriver to tighten this mainspring screw. And there we are.
We put the buttstock on, the buttstock screw. Now, we already know that we're going to need to do a little fitting because this lever doesn't close. So we've got this thing pushed up good and tight. So we're going to have to do some fitting here. We're going to have to kind of figure out what's holding it back and maybe take a little metal off somewhere to get it going. Okay, so I've been looking things over to see exactly what it's going to take to get this bolt to fit properly. And I think we found the culprit, what's holding it up and keeping that lever from closing and getting this bolt face all the way up where it needs to be. So let's take a closer look.
Well, it looks to me like this part of the bolt is coming right up against this milled out part of the receiver right here. And so let's take a look at it a little bit closer here. And so you see it comes right up against that part of the receiver and it makes a metallic clank when it comes forward. Let's test out that theory. I've got a dab of Prussian blue here we can rub in here on this part of the bolt or on this part of the receiver. And then if it transfers to that part of the bolt, we'll know that's where it's coming in contact. We can even hear it change sound a little bit there. And yeah, we've got blue all over that. So we know we're going to have to take some material off there now to get that bolt to close all the way up. And so in order to kind of get an idea of how far we need to go, I took this field gauge. And then, like I showed you earlier, our quick and easy way to get kind of a rough estimate of how far we need to go, I put four layers of scotch tape on here. And to put this scotch tape on, you just put a piece on it and then take a X-Acto knife or a razor blade and just trim the edges. And I worked this up to where it started making a little bit different sound when it came closed. So I figured that the bolt face is now touching that. And up until then, it was making the same noise. We could hear that, just that part of the bolt here hitting the front of the receiver. So we figure four pieces is about 8 thousandths.
Okay, there's nothing high tech about this method. We're just gonna work this down until we get about 10 to 12 thousandths off of it. And we'll take it back and see if it fits up and we can get that lever to close up. Okay, so we've been polishing up the front of this bolt here and we've taken about 15 thousandths off and we've been bringing it back and testing it along the way. And we actually took off a little more than I was expecting to get there, but I think we're just about there. So let's give it a try now. We'll get it in the receiver here, get the finger lever in and see if that lever won't close all the way. So far, we haven't had to touch the locking block or the back of the bolt where it locks in, and hopefully we won't have to. Yep, there we go. We've got the lever closed all the way. Okay, so let's try now and see if we can get the field gauge, it to close on the field gauge. Nope, we can see it comes quite a ways from closing on that field gauge. Get it back open again. Okay, so let's try the no-go gauge. Get in there. There we go. And again, it doesn't quite close on the no-go gauge. It's getting fairly close. Okay, so we know that we're within specs, maximum specs. Let's see about minimum specs. And here's the very best go gauge there is. My good friend Brad Miller sent me some brand new Virgin 3855 brass after I was whining in our last episode about not having any. Thank you, Brad. We'll use it as a go gauge because that's the most important thing, is whether it's going to close on the brass or not. And there she goes. So we're right there, closes right on the brass. It's not over even go gauge spec, so it's in the area where it should be when we've very first put the chamber in. So this is a great, I mean, that's set up just perfectly now. We've got a couple more things to do. We've got to, first one just kind of cosmetic. We can see we got, it's old bluing because this is new old stock, this old bolt, but it doesn't really match the finish. So we're going to do some color matching, just cosmetically make it look a little better. And while we're doing that, we're going to load up some of this brand new brass with some black powder cartridges, and then we're going to take it out and test fire. So stick around, we're about ready for the moment of truth here shortly. Okay, so I was planning to load some black powder loads to test fire this old girl. But before I started loading, I decided I better slug the bore. And when I did, I got a bit of a surprise. This bore is oversized, about 382 to 383. The biggest bullet that I drop is a 380, or that's the biggest sizing die I've got. And all of those bullets that I had are lubed with smokeless lube. So I went ahead and loaded some light loads with 5744, and we're going to test that out. I've got a pretty soft lead bullet, so I'm hoping that it'll pump up a little bit, but I don't think accuracy is going to be great with this one. When it goes back to the owner, I've warned him he probably better be looking for some oversized bullets and see just how big a bullet will chamber in this gun, and then maybe he can get it to shoot accurately. But we're going to take a shot up pretty close here, about 25 yards out, and just see if it's stabilizing that bullet, and then we can check out the brass and see if we're getting the primer's backing out, or if we've solved that issue. Okay, so I was planning to load up some black powder loads to test fire this old girl. But before I started loading, I decided I'd better slug the bore. And when I did, I got a bit of a surprise. This bore is oversized, about 382 to 383. The biggest bullet that I drop is a 380, or that's the biggest sizing die I've got. And all of those bullets that I had are lubed with smokeless lube. So I went ahead and loaded some light loads with 5744, and we're going to test that out. I've got a pretty soft lead bullet, so I'm hoping that it'll pump up a little bit, but I don't think accuracy is going to be great with this one. When it goes back to the owner, I've warned him he probably better be looking for some oversized bullets and see just how big a bullet will chamber in this gun, and then maybe he can get it to shoot accurately. But we're going to take a shot up pretty close here, about 25 yards out, and just see if it's stabilizing that bullet, and then we can check out the brass and see if we're getting the primers backing out, or if we've solved that issue. Oh, I better get my glasses on. Okay, here we go, the moment of truth.
Okay, from here, if my eyes are good, it looks like a little round hole, so I'm hoping it's stabilized at this point, and then we'll back up and see if it'll stabilize from a further distance. Okay, so let's check out the brass, make sure we're not backing out primers. And nope, she looks nice. That's just right. Okay, let's back up and see if we can stabilize this bullet a little further back. Okay, so we're not anywhere near the bullseye, but we are making a little round hole, so we're getting a stable bullet at least at this point. Okay, so we're back at about 75 yards now, and we're going to take three shots and just see how well this thing will shoot and stabilize. You know, I'm doing a little research on these after I found that oversized bore. I see in Mike Venturino's book, Shooting Lever Guns of the Old West, he talks about this very issue with these 1893 Marlins and 3855 about many of the bores will slug at as much as 384. So this is kind of an unfortunate issue with these Marlins. They're well built, well designed on the action, but they can, at least in 3855, they can have some issues with bore diameter. Okay, so let's give this a try. Okay, there's one. And our third shot. Okay, we'll see if we're making little round holes right now. Okay, at 75 yards, the holes are not quite round, so we're starting to destabilize just about here. Obviously, a 380 bullet and a 382 to 383 bore is not a recipe for good bullet stabilization or accuracy. You can see we're kind of all over the paper here. So I had planned to do a little more shooting with it, but probably we're shaving lead and I don't want to lead up the fella's barrel. This is going to be a challenge, and that Mike Venturino talked about it. It was a really tough situation on these Marlin 3855s to get them to shoot accurately with that size of a bore. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's episode, maybe learned something along the way. We haven't been posting a lot lately, been so doggone busy, but I got several episodes in the works, so keep an eye out over the next few weeks. We got some pretty interesting episodes coming up. Until then, happy trails from the Cinnabar.